Welcome to Strength in the Numbers. My name is Andrew Codd, accountant, author, and commercial finance entrepreneur. And it's my job each week to bring you leaders in finance and business and deconstruct with them their real stories, insights, and hard-won lessons into practical advice on the key strengths and qualities you need to remain relevant in accounting and finance today, as well as the steps you can begin to take to elevate the impact you make to have a fun, successful, and rewarding career in accounting and finance. Now let's go over to the show. Hi everyone, and welcome to this week's Strength in the Numbers show. Now, are you a finance professional who's simply a passenger in the business, or are you a co-pilot? I mean, are you like a passenger who just sits there behind your desk, say, or in a row of desks, producing reports and analyses, or do you actually get up out from behind your desk, walk up to the decision makers, engage with them, understand their business, their challenges, and implications for the future, and in effect, are their co-pilot to add even more value to the business? These are just some of the areas our guest mentor this week, Arno Wakefer, and myself covered together on our latest podcast. And what I also really like about this podcast is that Arno just shares an awful lot of stories about his experiences. And one of the ones that really resonated with me was the value he found in mentors. And so much so, he's even set up his own business partnering mentoring program that you can reach out and connect with him on. And Arno's got an awful lot of experience in this space. Arno also shares with us his seven learnings or value drivers that accountants can look at to get a business running even more profitably and successfully, why reporting isn't adding value, and why Arno's actually excited about automation, where perhaps finance professionals need to be more visible, and how Arno actually does this himself, and also a really cool story about the best bit of criticism that Arno's ever received and how it really helped him actually add value in the business. So look, if you enjoy this episode, please let your friends and colleagues know about it. Rate, comment us on the major platforms, which is iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, and YouTube. And of course, you can always check out the detailed timestamp show notes with some key quotes and ways to connect with our guest mentor at sitnshow.com/podcast. So thanks for listening. I hope you enjoyed the show as much as I did interviewing Arno. So without further ado, over to Arno and the show. Arno, welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks, Andrew. Nice to be on the show, and I look forward to sharing my thoughts and talking to you in the audience.
Yeah, well, look, in terms of sharing your thoughts, you've written an awful lot of articles on LinkedIn, well over 100, I think over 130 at this stage, but some of our audience may not be as familiar with your background or journey in accounting finance, so do you mind perhaps sharing a bit about that with us, please?
Yeah, thanks, Andrew. You know, I've always wanted to be an accountant when I was back in school. I always had a passion for numbers and just storytelling, if I could put it that way. So as accountants, we like telling stories, the real stories, the factual stories. So my career started in 2004 when I qualified. I finished my articles at a small firm, and I decided to tackle the commerce world, to get my feet wet and to get some real experience. I wasn't crazy about auditing. It wasn't for me. It's very repetitive. And I actually wanted some real challenges and, you know, just getting out there and meeting different people and just learn what financial management is all about. So during my career, then I led a few of the divisional finance departments at some of the leading companies in such as Autodesk and IT company called Dimension Data, where I was mostly in financial manager positions, leading teams. And before I immigrated to Australia in 2016, I actually landed a job as a CFO for the largest business school in Africa, which is the Gordon Institute of Business Science. And that's really where I developed my passion for business, for people, for networking. And it was very challenging at that role. I had to walk in and what I always tell people is, as I walked in, the floor was slippery, and the more I slipped, the more soap they put on it. So I just slipping and slipping.
Love the expression.
So there wasn't time to sit still and think, you know. So I just was on the job, and I had to just implement improvements and transform the finance function. And yeah, so after that, we decided in 2014, my wife and I decided we want to immigrate to Australia. So we moved over in 2016, and then I decided to I wanted to go and manage a business. And you know, I just think it's always been a passion of mine, especially the small businesses. I just wanted to go and see what it feels like to run a small business, because I do think they're the ones that suffer the most pain, because they can't afford they can't afford the experience, or the expertise, and I just wanted to go and feel what they go through. So did that for a year, and then my wife and I decided we want to move east in Australia. We want to go check out Brisbane and the Gold Coast. Moved over last year, and then I landed another role as a group financial controller for an environmental services company. So that's kind of my career from 2014 now.
Yeah, we've a lot of similarities in there. I think we have a very similar passion for accounting, numbers, and storytelling. Yes. So that's very interesting. And also, on our journeys, we've gone through audit, commerce industry, and also ran our own businesses. So I'm just curious to think, like, what was the biggest learning for you as a finance professional with all this financial management training of running your own business that could perhaps be useful for our audience? And what would be the big learnings for you in that?
Yeah, so so when you're an accountant, you don't really understand what drives business, what the levers are. And my journey of running a business, I understand that it's 7 key drivers to cash flow and profitability. And funny enough, it all starts with leads, the number of leads. So if you don't have any interest in your business, you're not going to have business. So first driver is increase the number of leads coming in. Second driver is increase your conversion rates. So there's no point having leads and then you don't convert them. Third one is increase the average value of transaction. So get customers to buy higher price goods and services from you. Fourth one is increase the number of transactions. So instead of a customer buying from you once in a year, get them to buy from you 2, 3, 4 times. Then fifth one is increase your gross profit margins. So you do either do pricing. I don't like discounting products and services. Increase your price. Apply the 80-20 rule. You're probably going to lose a bit of business, but you're going to gain some. And then I think it was number six. It's obviously trim your overheads as much as you can. Run a mean, lean business. Lean, I prefer. I don't like to say cost cutting. I like to say mean, lean. You know, you do that through systems and processes and technology and all those things. So I think there's one that I've missed. But those are kind of where I'm going with this is you learn more than just the numbers. You learn what drives business. So you understand the levers. Then you need to look at business planning, giving a direction. You know, so the strategy part, and I think that's something that accountants don't necessarily look at is business strategy. They probably 100%. Look at, you know, they probably look at finance strategy, but you need to look at a business holistically from all aspects. And you know, that for me is something that I've really developed a passion for, is business strategy. You know, putting all the puzzles together.
Yeah, and that's really what I think that's where our profession's going. It's more into the puzzles side of things and solving puzzles and jigsaws and making sure the bits fit together logically and coherently, because, you know, you outlined the number of steps there. But if we don't get the business strategy right or understand that, so by that, I guess you actually, what do you mean by the business strategy? I mean, what sort of questions does that answer for us if we understand the business strategy?
So obviously it starts with vision, mission. What's your core capabilities? What's the values? Values is very important in a business. There's no point you having values and you hire people that don't share the same passion and vision and mission statement. Because then you're going to go, the one's going to go left and the other one's going to go right. You're not going to go in the same direction. So it's just getting the right people on the bus that share the same passion. So, and then you need people that can actually execute strategies. Right? So, because as you know, a lot of small, especially small businesses, okay, first of all, they don't have time to plan. Because they're running around to make revenue and pay salaries. But when they do find time, you know, strategy is one thing, but if you don't execute, then, you know, if you don't plan, you're planning to fail, as they say.
Yeah.
So, you know, no, I've seen it. You know, I've seen it. I manage a small business. I'm running finances now for SME. And it's tough. It's small business is a very different beast to the larger corporates. You know, they don't have that free time to work on the business. They're always working in the business. And, you know, it's just, for me as an accountant, it's getting people out of the business and say, listen, let's work on the business. And let's see how we can improve it. My career has always been on business improvements. You know, nothing is perfect. There's always room for improvement.
Yeah, 100%. I think you're completely right about business strategy. And you're actually highlighting a very useful advantage that comes from being a finance professional involved with SMEs, is that you can help them, I suppose, the leaders in there, the owners, actually step out of the business for a bit. You can help plan, you can help them see the business strategy so that they can go and execute better. And then you can make sure that all the seven drivers you outlined are more coherently aligned, so that the business is running in a more sustainable, profitable, and a way that's potentially going to grow over time.
Exactly, and that's the role of finance, is working with business. You don't work for business, you work with business to help them create a sustainable business. And it's an ongoing process, it never stops. But you've got to work with the business partners.
Yeah, it's like, I think that's that mindset shift though, isn't it? It's like, rather than working for a business, you know, it's actually working with them in sort of with a mindset of value creation, sustainable, profitable growth, and also business partnering over time. And I think that's the lever to make that happen, is that business partnering mindset. So, I mean, like with someone who was, you know, went through practice, like how did you stumble across the usefulness of business partnering?
You know, by engaging, earlier in my career, I was just managing finances from a desk. I didn't interact. I didn't engage. I was just pushing out reports. It was analysis paralysis. I was just looking at detail. And, you know, eventually I thought to myself, you know, what's the point of looking detail if I can't share it and I can't get input from people to maybe I'm missing something. Maybe I'm missing trends. I don't really understand the business. I don't understand how the divisions operate, what their processes are. And I think that was a mind shift for me, is to engage, you know, through business partnering. And you'll be surprised if you just start talking to people, you understand the business a lot better, and you actually understand their pain points, because finance has got two customers. They've got internal customers and external customers. Right. Definitely. So the internal customers, all the departments, they need to satisfy their needs. You know, that you need to give them reports, actual versus budget. They need to do systems and processes and all those things. And then obviously your external is like if you know your customers, billing statements or things like that. You know, so there's a big opportunity in finance to service a large customer base, if I can put it, a stakeholder base. And it all starts with conversation. You know, it's like typically what I tell people on LinkedIn. You know, if someone sends me an invite and you connect and you don't start a conversation, what's the point of connecting in the first place? It's just talk to people, find out what they're doing and how you can help service their business better. And that's what, I mean, we at the end of the day, finance serves people, you know, and that's what we are.
Yeah, and, you know, that's why I've got great hope for finance into the future, because we are all about servicing people. So we can have all this technology, digital finance agenda, and so on, but fundamentally business is about people, and as long as it's people to service, finance will play a role. But you know, we have to stay relevant, you know, and you suggested some very good areas there, Arno. I suppose in terms of the future of finance then, I suppose, what's exciting you most about that?
What's exciting is automation, because there's this thing about automation is going to take away the jobs of finance and accountants, which it won't. And the reason I say that is because what will happen is all the repetitive tasks and monthly reporting and those things will be automated, right? Which is great. What's going to happen is it's going to free up a lot more time for finance to actually roll up their sleeves and actually start talking to people and engaging and business, doing proper business partnering and creating value. Because if you're just pushing out reporting, you're really not adding value, because reporting is historical. You're just telling, what happened in the past, all right? So it's freeing up the time to work on predictions, to work on systemization, to work on growth, to work on strategy, and to what I call to become a co-pilot to driving future business performance. Because that's what finance is. We're a co-pilot. You know, we steer the plane, in a way, with the execs, with the leadership. And, you know, we need to make sure that if there's fuel, we need to make sure that, you know,
yeah, that's one of the fundamentals. Yeah, but it's like taking that fuel, right? Those fuel, insights, cash, and so on, and actually doing something with it, right? So influencing and executing, and it's just like you can only do that with engaging, right? The business partnering, as you were saying earlier, right, Arno?
Yes, 100%. You need to engage. I mean, it's and you know, accountants by most accountants don't, or mostly, I would say that probably most are introverts. But you know, I do think in today's society, I think I've seen guys that are more engaging, and I've definitely seen a shift. But you need to get out of your comfort zone, and you know, you need to be seen. I think you need to be visible. I actually wrote a LinkedIn article a while back about visible leadership. You need to be visible. You need to walk around, let people see you, introduce yourself. You'll be surprised if you put a name to a face, you know. It changes everything, you know. So, you know, just be seen, be visible, you know.
Yeah, and like that's an interesting one, because you know, for a lot of us now in the profession, with digital, it has allowed us to, you know, perform more global roles.
Yes.
So like in an SME, we just get out and, you know, walk around. It's more easily to be visible. But I suppose in global roles, it could be a bit tougher. I mean, I'm just back from a few weeks in the US, you know, walking around and being visible. But I mean, so maybe what sort of ways do you use to be visible, Arno, that might be useful for our audience?
Visible, you know, you can obviously with technology, you can do conference calls, you can use Zoom meetings. You can send out weekly reports. So visible, when I say visible, it can be different forms. Let people just hear from you more often, not just on a month end when you send a report. So just, I think, communicate more often. Let people just hear and see you. You know, that I think that is, for me, that's key. You know, that they shouldn't just see you once a month.
Great. No, I 100%. It's interesting, because I suppose we started talking about the future of finance, which is about automation, and then there's just some statistic jumped into my head about, by 2025, 80% of corporate audits will be performed by robots or robotic processes. So that, you know, that just shows that, I think, you know, we felt early on that it was important to move away from audit, because it's I suppose, one, it's probably not as much fun, but there's useful skills in that one. But on the other hand, it is about value creation. And, you know, we can have all these great ideas about value creations, but if we're invisible and not visible to the business, then we're not really going to make an impact. So like, I really appreciate you sharing some of those thoughts and ways of making it happen by, again, leveraging the digital technologies that are out there. And again, I'm a big user in some of the ones you mentioned. So highly recommend our audience check those out, and I'll include links as well in the show notes of those, because they're that important to helping us be more visible. So I suppose, I don't know, I do want to move on to some other areas, but before I do, there was one I wanted to touch on with you, because I think we're very big believers in this, is mentoring and the value of mentoring for our finance profession. So, I mean, what are your perspectives on mentoring and the value of mentoring?
Yeah, so I've told a few people, I wish I had a mentor when I qualified as a chartered accountant. And the reason for that is a mentor gives you what I call the shortcuts, and not the lazy cuts, the shortcuts.
I love that.
Yeah, it's just, you know, if I can think about all the times I went too much into the detail, and I didn't sit back and look at the business, and I just didn't apply my mind, the right mindset. And, you know, I was inexperienced. I didn't know where to look for things and who to talk to. And, you know, sometimes in business, sometimes in your role, you don't have a boss or a 2IC or something that you can actually go and talk to and run things past, you know, just run things off the bat, or just bounce some ideas off them, you know. Where I think, and that's what I like about a mentor. A mentor is you know, is independent. You'll give his perspective from a different angle, and it just, or fresh perspective, you know. So it's just, for me, it's just it gears you to think differently, and you learn quicker about business. So obviously you need to choose the right mentor. There's no point choosing a mentor that's totally left to what you're doing and can't add any value. And there's not a relationship thing. So mentorship is about the relationship. You need to find the right person. I do think, I have mentored a couple of accountants. I'm actually running a mentorship program that I started on LinkedIn about 2 weeks ago, where I'm just offering
all right.
my finance business partnering mentorship program, which I do for pro bono. And the whole idea is to take, you know, I've got certain selection criteria. I just tell the guys, listen, you know, guys that are 5 years in the business, are they looking at creating value in the business? And then I ask them questions. And then based on my criteria, I mentor the guys, you know. And I've got about seven areas of mentorship I look at. And it's all based on my experience because over the years, I've taught myself new skills. I recently became a financial modeler and valuation analyst with the CFI, the Corporate Finance Institute. Finance modeling is definitely a key skill, in my opinion, that accountants need to develop.
100%, definitely.
That is where prediction comes in, and that's where you actually have influence on decision-making. If you can talk the future of a business with the decision-makers, that for me is critical. So that's just one example of an area that I would typically I'm not going to tell guys how to do financial modeling. I'll just talk to them about principles and how it can add value in the business. So definitely mentorship. You know, I like doing that. I do think more business leaders need to give mentorship where they can. And as you'll see often on LinkedIn, for example, there's accountants reaching out. They're looking for mentors. So it's definitely a global trend. People want to be mentored.
Yeah, definitely. And I'll hold my hand up. I was very slow to do it. And if I had my time over again, I probably would have been a bit faster. But that said, you know, having not been as quick, I do now see the value of mentoring.
Yeah.
And that's why we do these podcasts, is to bring guest mentors on, like, you know, yourself, Arno, with fantastic experience, practical experience, and breaking it down so people can easily understand the steps forward. And I also find mentors useful because, you know, I'm definitely not perfect. I think we all make mistakes, but to bounce those off mentors and go through them and saying, you know, what would you have done differently, or help them bring that learning out of you. Yeah. So next time, you know, when we're a bit more experienced ourselves, we can pass those learnings on to others. So, you know, I like your expression, you know, shortcuts but not lazy cuts. Both sides, you know, put a bit of effort into it as well. And then overall, I believe, you know, it's like a rising tide that lifts all ships up. So thank you for sharing that, Arno. Great thoughts, great ideas. Yeah. I do have some more questions for you. I suppose the first would be, and you've been, you know, really great at sharing your advice with us. What's been the best bit of advice you've received?
I actually received criticism one day. It was the best criticism I ever received. Because it actually
I love it.
It actually put me on a journey to prove them wrong. So sometimes, I think, you know, you need to always take things with a pinch of salt. I always tell people, you can't worry too much about what other people may think of you or what you think they think of you, because most times they're not thinking that. So, you know, worry about yourself. I suppose getting back to the advice I got is, one day I was, was sitting in a boardroom, and one of the directors said, you can't do that because they'll eat me for lunch. So I thought, okay, so then you're saying I can't, I don't have the capacity to do it or the talent. So he said, yes. So I thought, okay, well, that's a challenge I'm going to take up. So thanks for the advice. Although it's negative, but I'm going to turn it into a positive. And so a few months, I won't go into the detail, but a few months down the line, I actually implemented to the solution that they said I wouldn't be able to do. And, so that for me is sometimes, you need that bit of a push and a drive to prove people wrong. You know, so, you can't take everything at face value. So, you know, the advice I always give, the advice I would give to the younger generation, if I was 20 or 30 years younger, is less is more. Don't look too much at the detail. Rather look for trends and warning signals. you'll cut out a lot of analysis paralysis. Look for trends. Look at things that stand out. And you'll be surprised. Those are the things, that's the problem areas. The second thing is be an uncompetitor. Don't compete with anyone else. Compete with yourself. And that's very important, because as soon as you start comparing yourself with other people, you're not going to get anywhere in life. Improve, improve, improve. Always try and do your best and improve. Last thing is, like I said before, nothing is perfect. There will always be room for improvement. Because in my career, I always wanted to get things up perfect, to get things up perfect. And you spend so much time that you actually lose the plot. You actually, you know, and I say rather get something out than get something out rather get it out, because then at least people will look at it quick and fit, and questions will come out sooner. And that goes for life in general. Nothing's perfect. We all know that.
Oh God, you made me laugh. I talking getting something out. Like, yeah. Please, I remember once I was on a. You've probably done similar now, Arno. Like I was editing a report for the board, and my predecessor, he was very meticulous about measuring the distance between the various charts. So it was a quadrant, four quadrants of four charts on one page with some text around. And I said, I almost lost the will to live trying to get to this level of perfection. I mean, I'm from the cut from the cloth of just getting stuff out. So so that's when nowadays using automation and I think, what was it? You know, turning rather than sending spreadsheets out, just have them all formatted to be sent out, not wasting too much time on worrying about the minutiae of where a chart is in terms of its proportion or relative position to other ones. I mean, like, God, you have to go through these things sometimes, right? And to realize the futility of it.
Yeah,
ultimately, just gets...
No, but you're right, Andrew. The other point about automation, it's making us lazy. Because we're actually not looking at the reports. We're assuming they're correct. You know, if the design's wrong or the garbage in, garbage out. You know, so every now and again, do your checks. You know, something that's wrong and that's automated is going to cause you real problems. So always have checks and balances, validation controls in place. You know, and automation is not just a once-off exercise. Technology develops.
100%. And it comes back to our fundamental credibility. Like, we have to earn the right to be able to share those insights.
Yes.
And communicate with others. So to do that, and like that's we skirt over that a lot, but validation checks, so key, you know. And also I really enjoyed your point there around trends. I've dropped the whole SWOT analysis now: strength, weakness, opportunities, threats. It's all about strengths, weaknesses, and trends for me now. So three dimensions. So no, that's great advice. And I suppose in terms of, would there be any other resources you could recommend we check out? I mean, what resources would you use or recommend our audience check out?
Yes. So I listen to a lot of podcasts and I read quite often. I'm a lazy reader. I actually do Audible and Amazon because at least I'm reading a book in some way. So I listen to, like, for example, I listen to your show all the time. I listen to a lot of business coaches, business profession podcasts and things like that. But the two that I would recommend, the podcast, the book actually that I read recently it's by James Shramko. He's a Australian business coach. He's got this book it's called Work Less, Make More. And what he talks about is he talks about the EHR principle. And what the EHR principle stands for, it's the effective hourly rate. So what he talks about is, You need to work out what your effective hourly rate to benchmark whether you take on work in to make money. And all it is you just take your available hours, take what money you want to take home and divide it by your available hours, and that's your EHR rate. And what you need to do is you need to beat that EHR rate consistently to build up wealth. And I think you can apply that in business as well. It's like your break even. So that's one thing that I took out from his book, and I listened to a lot of his podcasts. So he's James Shranko. The second one that I'm busy reading now, it's Steve Olsher. It's a book called What Is Your What? And what it's about is it's discovering your true purpose in life. And I think it's because of my age. I'm getting to an age where I want to, you know, this is I want to do more, and I want to just add more value to people I serve. And you know, so it's just discovering, I suppose, just, you know, rediscovering myself and what are my strengths, what are my passions. And it's just realigning, and I'm used to rediscovering myself again. So those are kind of the two that stands out for me that I would recommend. Plus a few podcasts, other podcasts, but I mean, obviously yours. it's good. YouTube as well. Like, quick, you got the zippy, what do you call them? The bite-sized videos. I like them.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, the Monday memos. Yes, yes.
There we go. They're good. I listen to them in the car as well, so it's good.
Oh, excellent. Thanks. Thanks, Erdo. And I suppose, you know, if our audience want to continue the conversation, where's the best place to connect with you at?
Definitely LinkedIn. I'll try and publish articles at least once every week or every second week. But definitely LinkedIn, you know, that's my platform. I've tried to build a nice brand. And I'm an active network user, like a LinkedIn user. And I like to meet different people and have conversations and see where I can help and share knowledge and experience.
Yeah, no, definitely. You've been fantastic, leaving fantastic comments on the post I've made, and I've seen some of the other articles you've done as well, Arno. So I suppose in terms of our audience, would you have any parting thoughts for us?
I think for me, the accounting profession, where I think it, my advice to accountants would be to become business and tech savvy. Try and learn new skills all the time. Because when you've got those skills, you'll understand how a business makes money. You'll understand how business can make more money. And then also you'll understand how you can use technology to get you there. So that would be my advice to accountants in terms of value creation, is just understand business and how to use technology to implement your actions, your thoughts.
That's great parting thoughts, Arno. Well, look, really appreciate you making the time for us, particularly given it's your evening over in Brisbane. Also taking us through your thoughts around the future of finance, why business partnering is an important mindset for us to have, also sharing your journey on mentoring as well, and and also that a bit of not best bit of advice, but best bit of criticism, and also how we can create value for our businesses as accountants and finance professionals. So again, really appreciate you investing the time with us today and coming on our show.
Thanks, Andrew. It was absolutely a pleasure, man, and I'm sure I hope we talk again.
So there you have it. Hope you enjoyed today's show. If you'd like to know more about our guests today, their bio, and follow up on the resources mentioned during the show, you can find all the relevant links and more at sitnshow.com. There you'll also be able to get access to earlier shows, read the latest blogs. There's also an opportunity to subscribe to our newsletter, which will give you heads up as to when the next show is coming out, latest events, news, and anything that's going to be relevant to help you have a fun, rewarding, and successful career in finance and accounting. And just before you go, we really appreciate your feedback. If there's something we can do better on the show, something that's not working, or something you'd like to see, even a guest you'd like for us to invite onto the show, someone who you think might be able to benefit you more and also the rest of our community, please let me know. You can email me. I'm at andrew@sitnshow.com, or feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn. Just drop me a message so I know how you found me and we can connect. And really, it's our community that will make the show. If we keep engaging and driving each other on, we'll keep on building our strength in the numbers. And when all is said and done, if we can do the numbers better and finance better, we'll create more opportunities for ourselves, our friends, our families, our communities, and our businesses. So until next time, have a good rest of the week. Take care. And let's keep building our strength in the numbers.